On December 6, 2025, at the border of Canada and the United States, the ground began to rapidly and strongly shake back and forth. The ground motion was not brief either, lasting for a full minute, as a major magnitude 7.0 earthquake had struck. If anyone had somehow hypothetically lived in the area the strongest ground motion occurred, damage would have likely looked similar to this simulation. Yet, instead of there being localized catastrophic damage and more widespread moderate damage, there were in reality zero reports of any actual damage. The reason? This shallow major earthquake, which was the strongest to strike Canada's Yukon territory in 124 years, was centered beneath a completely unpopulated icefield, aka a complex of glaciers in a remote spot, with the closest populated settlement being 56 miles away in the town of Yakutat. Yakutat only experienced MMI 4.5 intensity ground motion, equal to this simulation, which you can see was unlikely to have caused any damage. Many people in Fairbanks, Anchorage, and Whitehorse also felt this earthquake at a lesser extent, the latter of which was partially recorded by my science engineer contact in Yukon.
There's an earthquake happening right now.
While no damage to structures occurred, there almost certainly was widespread landslides and avalanches that occurred close to the earthquake epicenter, alongside some limited liquefaction associated with sedimentary areas near the toe of Alaska's Malaspina Glacier. Furthering my suspicion that some form of landslides did occur, the ocean buoy closest to Yakutat measured a displacement in the water of up to 8 centimeters or 3.1 inches, suggesting a very tiny landslide-generated tsunami might have been generated. But why did this large earthquake that represented the fifth largest to occur beneath a Canadian landmass in recorded history occur in the first place? Simple, an ongoing tectonic plate boundary. As in this part of Canada and Alaska, you have the North American plate to the east, which is moving to the southwest, and the Pacific plate to the west, which is moving to the northwest. This created a lengthy transform plate boundary with laundry horizontal motion that is primarily accommodated via the Fairweather Queen Charlotte Fault. However, some of this regional tectonic stress is instead accommodated by faults that attach to the aforementioned major fault line, allowing it to build up and slip there instead on occasion. In this case, the offshoot fault that moved on December 6, 2025 was known as the Art Lewis Glacier Fault, which, as you might note, marks a regional weak point that glaciers carved through during the Pleistocene. It is likely that about 41 of this fault line's 132-kilometer-long length moved at a depth of 10 kilometers or 6.2 miles, moving in an oblique manner that consisted of both a right lateral strike slip component and thrust fault component. Other major magnitude 7 range earthquakes have occurred on or in the vicinity of the Fairweather Queen Charlotte Fault, albeit on other parts of it, in 1927, 1958, 1972, and 2013. In the next few days, weeks, and even months, a series of aftershock earthquakes will almost certainly occur, although statistically speaking, the odds of any larger quakes soon occurring on the same fault line is quite unlikely. Aftershocks will tend to decrease in abundance as time progresses at a 1 over x rate, with this forecast suggesting the probabilistic chances of various magnitudes of aftershocks occurring in given time frames. Thanks for watching, and I hope that you found this video interesting. As a final note, I would like to thank my YouTube channel member, SOJ Nexus Philip, for supporting my work.